Please turn in your Bibles to Luke chapter 19. And Luke's account of the Palm Sunday event, or what's called the triumphal entry. Let's read God's word. It begins at verse 28. Our portion this morning of the word begins at Luke 19, verse 28, and I'm going down to verse 40. Let's give our attention as God's word is read. Luke 19, 28 to 40. And when Jesus had said these things, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. When he drew near to Bethpage and Bethany, at the mount that is called Olives, or Olivet, he sent two of the disciples, saying, "Go into the village in front of you, where on entering you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever sat. Untie it and bring it here. If anyone asks you, 'Why are you untying it?' you shall say this, 'The Lord has need of it.' So those who were sent went away and found it just as he had told them. And as they were untying the colt, its owners said to them, 'Why are you untying the colt?' And they said, 'The Lord has need of it.' And they brought it to Jesus, and throwing their cloaks on the colt, they set Jesus on it. And as he rode along, they spread their cloaks on the road. As he was drawing near, already on the way down the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen, saying, 'Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest.' And some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to him, 'Teacher, rebuke your disciples.' He answered, 'I tell you, if these were silent, the very stones would cry out.'" Let us pray. O Lord, your word has been read. It has been opened and read. We have heard it. And now we ask that you would illuminate it. Send your Holy Spirit. Open our eyes that we may see wonderful things in your law. Open our ears, Lord, that we may hear the words of life. And God, guide our feet into the way of peace and truth. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Shortly after the start of Gulf War II, May 1st, 2003, our President George Bush boarded the USS Abraham Lincoln and declared the end of major combat operations in Iraq. And behind him was a sign that's now become famous that said, "Mission accomplished." For critics of the president, the irony of the moment is that he gave a victory speech only a few weeks after the beginning of what would become the fifth longest war in U.S. history. Well, if there was hubris and pride there, and I suspect there was, it didn't begin with that Republican administration. In fact, every president, every ruler, every king seems to excel in these particular virtues or vices of pride. It seems like all rulers are always looking for ways to make things that they had very little to do with look bigger and take more credit for it than they actually did. And in today's passage, which is in my Bible, the editors of the ESV and probably your Bible too say the triumphal entry, it's a header that's added to help us understand where we're at in the text. It's called the triumphal entry. And Jesus also essentially announces mission accomplished, or certainly the crowds do. They're declaring a great victory. He enters Jerusalem, the city where his suffering and death were awaiting him. This may also seem to us like a premature announcement. How can we call this a triumphant entry? Hosanna, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord, when in a few days he will be tortured and crucified in the most cruelest manner in this very city. So important are the things that follow Palm Sunday that some traditions of the church actually call it Passion Sunday. because it kicks off the Passion Week. And it isn't even that the triumph lasts a day. It doesn't even last all of Sunday. Betrayal and tragedy doesn't wait for Maundy Thursday when he's betrayed, or Good Friday when he's crucified. Rather, on Palm Sunday, on Passion Sunday, immediately after this probably relatively brief procession, he goes straight to the temple, cleanses it, and weeps over Jerusalem as he looks at the city that has killed the prophets and would soon kill him. So why does Scripture refer to it as a triumphal entry? Is it an ironic media error as the mission accomplished sign? I actually think the answer is no. That the answer is that his triumph, and this is truly a declaration of a true triumph, and his suffering and death, they actually go together. By going into the city of Jerusalem, the capital city, amid shouts of victory, he is actually describing in some ways the very nature of his kingdom and of the victory that is being announced. In fact, as we'll see in a little bit, the word Hosanna means, Lord, save us. Even though in a few days' time no one will hardly remember the shouts of joy, ironically, this is where his suffering begins. We can see that by his weeping cries over the city. Jesus of Nazareth is both son of David, heir to the throne, rightful king of Israel, and the Messiah who had come to suffer for the sins of his people. I think this highlights a problem for most of us who follow Jesus Christ. We have trouble keeping the kingship of Christ, his victory, his triumph, together in tension with his suffering and death. Both parts of our Lord's Passion Week, Passion Sunday with his victory entrance, and, if you will, Passion Thursday and Friday with his suffering and death, it's hard to remember that they belong together. There's something deep within us, and cultural critics might call it our sense of entitlement. Maybe historians might call it our American identity or our identity as members of a Western democracy. It may be just your own personality, the value that you place on hard work, that you believe that hard work deserves to be rewarded. Whatever it may be, most of us who are listening to this message this morning have a problem with Jesus' ironic and offbeat, unorthodox, unexpected, triumphal entry. And so that's true of the preacher as well. I come to this text having learned about it 400 times in Sunday school. And the main thing I remember are palm branches. I don't know why. And so if you grew up in the church, you may also be fatigued or not really have ever stopped to think about what Palm Sunday is really about. But it is important. And in my preparations for this message, I was reminded that this is one of only a handful of stories in the Gospels that is written of and included by all four Gospel writers, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. So while the writers used editorial judgment in choosing to include this and not choosing to include that in the life of our Lord, which is why we get such sometimes seemingly different and apparently at times contradictory accounts of our Lord's life, this one, all four writers made sure to include. Now, Matthew's account is the only one which records both the foal or the baby colt and its mother being included in the procession. Mark, ours, Luke, and John only record the baby donkey in that procession. All four texts, though, reveal the importance of keeping the victory parade of our Lord closely connected to his death. They also all record the confusion that shortly ensues after the victory parade. So I think we're invited then by the prominence and the significance that the Holy Spirit has given to this passage, we're invited both to make it important and to see how we ourselves may be confused by it. And while we may struggle to keep God's victory and our suffering or his suffering together, Palm Sunday, this triumphal entry, helps us. So let's see what we can learn about our faith and the challenge of keeping victory and suffering together in the Passion Week of our Lord. So my sermon this morning, if you're taking notes, is called The Victory of Suffering. We're going to consider 3 points. Our Lord's royal announcement, first of all. Second of all, his prophetic fulfillment. And third, his solemn warning. First then, the victory of suffering has a royal announcement. I want to look at 2 elements here, the timing of the announcement and also the nature of the announcement. I mentioned this mission accomplished banner on the aircraft carrier in my opening remarks. In fact, it betrayed a much longer, more protracted war. I'm not so sure for the record that the president was wrong to have done that. Nevertheless, it did give a kind of conclusion to something that people would learn to realize would take a lot longer. In fact, we're still involved in that conflict today. It's a much more protracted war. I think likewise, Jesus' victory announcement may hide for us a much more protracted battle than we're prepared to accept. The president in that speech says we have more work to do, and in a sense, Jesus is saying something similar. As he receives the accolades and the praises of the crowds, and then proceeds to weep over the city, he is saying there is much more work to do for this victory to be fully realized. And so this aspect of timing is something that the Jews struggled with. Again and again, the timing of Jesus' messianic program was a problem for the Jews. This wasn't the first time, by the way, that the crowds attempted to make or proclaim Jesus as king. If you'd like, you can flip to John 6:15, where John says this about Jesus. Perceiving then that the crowds, this is after the feeding of the 5,000, in John's account of that, John writes, perceiving then, after the feeding of the 5,000, that the crowds were about to come and take him by force and make him king. John 6. John wouldn't record the triumphal entry until John 12. So very early on in Jesus' ministry, people are acknowledging that this may be the messianic king. And even though that he said, no, I don't want to be king, they were going to literally take him by force and make him king. And so John says, to avoid that, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. That happens to me a lot. People come and want me to be king, and I have to just secretly withdraw myself to the mountain for prayer. Likewise, when Jesus was going up to Jerusalem for one of the feasts, this is also in John's Gospels, his brothers were urging him to make himself publicly known. I'm going to read this. We'll read this together. Let's flip to John chapter 7 on this one. John chapter 7 and verse 1 says, after this, Jesus went about in Galilee. He would not go about in Judea because the Jews were seeking to kill him. Now the Jews' feast of booths or of tabernacles was at hand. So his brothers, by the way, that's part of the tradition of palms, is that feast of booths where they take foliage from trees and they wave it and they use it to construct tents or temporary dwellings as a way of remembering that God protected his people in the wilderness wanderings. So this has some special connection to Palm Sunday. The Jews' feast of booths was at hand. So his brother said to him, leave here and go to Judea that your disciples also may see the works you are doing, for no one works in secret if he seeks to be known openly. That phrase, seeks to be known openly, is kind of code language for seeks to be king. If you do these things, show yourself to the world. This is kind of maybe the ancient equivalent of an announcement that you're running for the presidency or something like that. For not even his brothers believed in him. So we get a little bit of their motives there in verse 5. And Jesus said to them, my time has not yet come. Do you see the problem of timing here? My time has not yet fully come. He repeats that twice in his comments. But in the triumphal entry on Palm Sunday, his time has come. There is no indication in our passage that I read that Jesus is like, calm down, everybody. Not so much enthusiasm. Too many palm branches. You know, that's too loud. No. Don't bother taking off your cloaks and throwing them on the colt for me. Don't bother lifting me up on the colt. Don't bother leading me down the mount from Olivet into the city. Don't bother quoting scripture that only could make sense if it's in reference to a messianic king. No, don't do that. I wouldn't want people to get the wrong impression. No, Jesus is like, bring it on. This is it. This is his time. The time for the big announcement has come. We struggle with timing in our everyday lives. I know I do. If you get laid off or promoted, when do you let people know? If you find out with your wife or your husband that your wife is expecting, when do you let people know? Especially if you have miscarried before. Well, what if we let everyone know and then we don't get to keep this baby? If you're dating someone, when do you post it on Facebook? It's a thing these days, I'm told. The disciples would struggle again and again with timing. And look at our context, by the way. In Luke 19, the triumphal entry begins in verse 28 of my Bible. If you look to the previous passage, just one passage prior to, it's called the parable of the 10 minas. 19:11, Luke 19, verse 11. Listen to this, just to prove what we're talking about, the timing. And as they, the disciples, heard these things, he proceeded to tell a parable because he was near to Jerusalem and because they supposed that the kingdom of God was to appear immediately. The disciples were all ready for the kingdom of God to appear. And so it's as if he tells this parable right before the announcement of his kingship to let them know that this is going to be a long time. But they still didn't get it. After the triumphal entry, after that parable, after the crucifixion, the resurrection, he instructed them for 40 days. And do you know the last recorded question that the disciples asked Jesus before he ascended into heaven? They said, will you, at this time, restore the kingdom to Israel? This is one of these great doofus moments where it's like, these guys have gone through the graduate class with the Lord of Lords and King of Kings about everything related to the kingdom of God and the scriptures, going through the whole Old Testament, showing them how each one pointed to him and to his kingdom. And the last thing they see fit to ask him is, now, when is it coming again? He says, no, you will be my witnesses, which brings me to a second aspect of the royal announcement. Its nature. The idea of the royal announcement is the victory of his suffering shows us not only about the unique timing of this, but also it points to its nature. Here's the idea. If we're announcing a victory that's going to end in my death, says Jesus, and which will inaugurate a kingdom which will only be realized in spirit now, and will wait for an indeterminate amount of time before we realize it in fact and with our sight and not simply by faith, then this is a very different kind of kingdom, isn't it? This is a very different program. And then look at the way that he makes his announcement. He sends two of his disciples to Bethpage, or Bethany, one of the two, to get a colt and its mother, because its mother came with it, even though Luke doesn't point that out. And this is a colt on which no one has ever sat. Now, the significance of that, by the way, is that in the ancient world, in the ancient Near East in particular, sometimes animals were reserved for royalty, and so you weren't allowed to sit on them. And so this idea that a colt on which no one has ever sat is somewhat of an indication that it's going to be used for a special purpose, or that Jesus is appropriating it for a special purpose. By the way, I wouldn't recommend this procedure in your own life. Like, don't go to your neighbor, or don't send your two friends or your brothers to your neighbors and borrow the car. When they ask, "What are you doing with my car?" say, "The Lord has need of it." That doesn't work in ordinary life, trust me. But I do think probably, the text doesn't tell us this, probably Jesus arranged this ahead of time. I suppose it could have been a supernatural provision that the Holy Spirit just enabled this farmer, this animal owner, to just release it in the moment. But I suspect that he had arranged for this ahead of time. So this royal mount is acquired, and its mother. And then the animals are brought to Jesus, and Jesus is sat on the one on which no one has ever sat before after clothing is covering it. And then the entrance to the city, on the way down the Mount of Olives, verse 37, the whole multitude of his disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works that they had seen. It's interesting, in terms of the nature of this announcement, they're responding to the mighty works of God. So what qualifies him to be king, in other words, is the things that he's been doing. Specifically, the week before this announcement took place, Lazarus was raised from the dead. So what makes the nature of this announcement unique is that it is in response to a resurrection. The kind of king we're looking at here, therefore, is someone who rides in on a donkey, having just raised a man from the dead. The waving of palms is a celebration of redemption from Egypt. I mentioned it earlier, related to the Feast of Tabernacles. It's a different program, is what I'm getting at. I imagine that the readers, Luke was a Gentile, and I imagine that the people who read this might have been the first time they'd ever read about a king proceeding into his city, his capital city, on a donkey rather than, say, on a stallion. It's not that the Jews didn't have a tradition of this. They certainly understood war stallions, but there is a specific tradition of this particular messianic king, and we'll get to this in a moment, coming in on a donkey or a colt. Jesus would say in John 18 that my kingdom is not of this world. This entrance really helps us see that, doesn't it? It reveals that this is a different kind of kingdom. The nature of this announcement shows us that. It's also a different kind of kingdom. The nature of the kingdom, we see it in the beginning of Luke 19. There's no question that not only the disciples, but every resident in Jerusalem resented the presence of the Roman Empire. They saw themselves as being, it would be like if Russia were to occupy the White House. You know, after 100 years or 200 years, we might tolerate it, but if we knew our history books, we couldn't embrace it, could we? In that way, in that same idea, that same patriotic feeling would have been directed resentment toward the Romans. So what kind of kingdom, what kind of announcement is directly preceded by this in Luke 19, verse 1, when a town just in the outer suburbs of Jerusalem, Jericho, Jesus passes through and he winds up embracing, forgiving, and then dining with a man named Zacchaeus, who is in a co-conspirator with the Roman oppressors as a tax collector. So having just done this, Jesus then announces his kingship. This is a different kind of kingdom, isn't it? If Jesus had any fans among the Tea Party, the Patriot class in Jerusalem at the time, his lunch with Zacchaeus ended that relationship right away. So the timing of this announcement is unique, as also its nature is unique. But its nature is tied to my second point, which is prophetic fulfillment. The victory of suffering takes place. These two ideas are put together because it's embedded in the very heart of the Bible. If we go all the way back to Genesis chapter 3, the first messianic prophecy after the sin was committed in the garden, and God holds each person who was party to that event, starting with Adam, and then Eve, and then the serpent. He says that the serpent will bruise the heel of the seed of the woman, but the seed of the woman will crush his head. So pastors understand that bruising of the heel to refer to the seed of the woman, that is Christ, the Messiah, and his sufferings. And why a bruise? And why is the head of the serpent crushed and the heel of the Messiah, the promised Messiah, they're only bruised? It's because the defeat of the devil would be permanent, but the wounding, if you will, of the Messiah would be temporary. And it was, wasn't it? Because when Jesus went into the grave, as we would see here on Good Friday, he will be killed. 3 days later, he will rise from the dead. His heel was bruised, but he will recover. Well, the specific prophecy, though, that we see in Palm Sunday comes from Zechariah chapter 9. So this is going to test your Bible skills. We need to find this little Z book in the end of the Old Testament. Use the table of contents if you need to. Zechariah chapter 9 has the words that are fulfilled in Luke 19. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. This is Zechariah chapter 9, verse 9. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout aloud, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. Righteous and having salvation is he. Humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. And then verse 10, I will cut off the chariot from Ephraim and the war horse from Jerusalem, and the battle bow shall be cut off, and he shall speak peace to the nations. His rule shall be from sea to sea and from the river to the ends of the earth. And then verse 11, as for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you, I will set your prisoners free from the waterless pit. Well, I'm going to make a couple comments about this prophecy. This is my second point, which is the victory of suffering takes place because of prophetic fulfillment or because of prophecy. Do you see what's contrasted here in verse 9 and verse 10? There's actually two animals that are contrasted. We have the colt or the donkey in verse 9. What's the animal in verse 10? A war horse, a war steed. So some people think that this is a kind of proof that the Bible is kind of a pacifist treaty, or that the Christians should be pacifist, or that Jesus is against violence, or Jesus is against war. And it is true in a sense that Jesus is against violence and war. But what's being contrasted here is actually the might and power of man, or of humans, and the might and power of God. And so what verse 10 says is he cuts off the chariot from Ephraim. That's the northern tribes of Israel. And he cuts off the war horse, or the stallion, from Jerusalem. That's the center of the southern tribes. And the battle bow shall be cut off. So the weapons are cut off. So when God cuts them off, he's saying, invalid, doesn't work, not useful in this context. In other words, the problems that you have cannot be solved by your human efforts. So the Messiah, the solution, the king, rides in on a donkey, not on a war stallion, not because he's against war, but he's against your attempts to fight your own war. That's why he's on a donkey. And so we combine these two things together that don't seem to go together. I embrace Christ because he's embraced me. I fight the battle because he won the battle. My victory is in his suffering. These two seemingly irreconcilable things, in other words, are put together because the Bible puts them together. It's part of what it means, the very heart of what it means, I would say, to be a Christian. And then look at verse 11 again. As for you also, because of the blood of my covenant with you. Does that sound familiar? The blood of the covenant. Well, it shows up in two other places in the Bible. One in Exodus 24, when God first describes or explains the nature and the importance of sacrifice. And then again, in the upper room, in Passion Week, in Holy Week. So the solution, the king comes into the city, invalidating human solutions, the battle bow, the war stallion, and so forth. And this king, this solution, will work a victory through the blood of the covenant. There's another prophecy that's being fulfilled here, and it's alluded to in Zechariah chapter 9, and it's the prophecy of Passover. They say that the Passover lamb was selected a certain number of days before the Passover itself, and the Passover takes place during the Feast of the Unleavened Bread. There's three major feasts during the year, and in this first feast of the year, the springtime feast, there's three major holy days that are celebrated during the feast. The point being is that the Passover lamb was selected about a week before Passover was taking place. So there's an implied fulfillment of prophecy here in that the king, the solution, God's Messiah, is coming into the city at the acclaim of the word, Hosanna, save us, save us. At the very time, probably somewhere else in the city, the Passover lamb was being selected. Which brings me to another prophetic fulfillment that we see in our passage for Palm Sunday. Turn, this will be our last Old Testament reference. I'm permitted three per Sunday, so. Psalm 118. Psalms are in the middle of your Bible. Psalm 118. I read from some of this psalm for my call to worship this morning. I'm going to pick up about where I left off in Psalm 118. I read for the call to worship verses 14 through 17. I'm going to start at verse 19. Psalm 118, verse 19. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. So here we have a picture. By the way, this is one of the Hallel Psalms. 113 to 118 form a unit of psalms that were sung at this time of year, often at the Feast of Tabernacles, sometimes at the Feast of Passover. This was common praise that was uttered. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. So you can picture Jesus coming through the gates of Jerusalem. It's not important which gate it was. He's coming through one of those gates, and we see this psalm being fulfilled in his triumphal entry. I thank you that you have answered me and have become my salvation. Now look at this, verse 22. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. Now, in our passage, where do we see the builders rejecting this? Back in Luke 19. Well, the religious leaders, the Pharisees, turn to Jesus and say, Teacher, tell your disciples to be quiet. So the praise that they are offering directly to Jesus as the Messiah, welcoming him as king, they turn to him and say, kind of like, you must be crazy. And Jesus says, no. If they're silent, the stones will cry out. The rocks will cry out. It's interesting, the word stone is also used here in verse 22 as a coincidence. The stone that the builders rejected, it's thinking of like a stone in the temple, has become the cornerstone. The the chief stone of the corner. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day, verse 24, that the Lord has made. Palm Sunday is that day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in us. And here it is in Hebrew, Hosanna, save us, we pray, O Lord. O Lord, we pray, give us success. And then this, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God. You can see why the Pharisees wanted Jesus to silence them, because they're quoting the Hallel Psalm, the greatest of the Hallel Psalms, Psalm 118, the heart of it in reference to Jesus. And in this psalm, the singer is the Lord, Yahweh, God. It's as if they're saying, teacher, i.e., rabbi, i.e., you know the blasphemy laws. Tell them to stop if you're a teacher. And he says, no. No. And then this, he has made his light to shine upon us. So the one who is blessed becomes the blesser. Can you see that? Bind the festal sacrifice with cords up to the horns of the altar. No wonder the first thing that Jesus did after he entered the city was to cleanse the temple and say, this is my Father's house. The reason that suffering and victory are attached in Holy Week with Passion Sunday, culminating with Passion Friday, the reason they're connected is because it's connected in prophecy. And binding the sacrifice to the altar as a way of saying thanks, do you know how that was fulfilled? Jesus offered himself on the altar of divine justice, a sacrifice whose blood was shed for our sins. And he brought it himself. No wonder he cleansed the temple. My third point and my final point this morning is that the victory of suffering gives a solemn warning. Not only is it a royal announcement and prophetic fulfillment, it is a solemn warning. By coming into the city proclaiming to be king, Jesus is warning several groups of people. He's warning the Romans. Now, the Romans knew, because they were an occupying power, they knew when their territories were in some stress or when there was trouble brewing. And they knew that the Jews did not like their occupation. And they knew this was a patriotic day for them. Passover was the high and holy day for the Jews. So they had likely more than the usual number of garrisons stationed in Jerusalem at this time. It was also possible, in tradition, we're told, church tradition, that Pilate may have been entering the city at the same time. That's fascinating to think that that might have been taking place. Through one of the gates of the city, here's Pilate on a war stallion in shining golden armor with banners furling in the wind, spears and swords and soldiers accompanying him. And then a much less significant crowd of people waving palm branches, throwing their peasant cloaks in the road, and a man, a poor peasant rabbi, on a donkey is riding into a city through another gate at the very moment. It's interesting to think that that might have been the case. Here's the warning. Earthly rulers, presidents, governors, police, all magistrates, emperors, kings, and queens, the king has come. The warning that Pilate would hear face to face, do you not realize that I have the authority of life and death and that I can kill you in a moment? And Jesus, looking Pilate straight in the eye, the representative of the superpower of the day, the governor, Pilate, Jesus said, you would have no authority if it weren't given to you by God. That's the warning. The warning in our day and age, our power-hungry, egocentric, self-centered day and age, to all who have authority, is that the king has come, and you would have no authority if it were not given to you by God. He also warns the Romans and all other political regimes all through history. He warns them that your time on the stage is limited. It's a warning because, by the way, the Roman Empire is no more. And the only reason we remember Pilate, or Caesar for that matter, is in reference to or with respect to their relationship to Jesus. His kingdom endures. All other human kingdoms will pass away. All other human rulers are worried about their legacy and writing their biography and setting up their libraries, if you will. But Jesus' kingdom endures forever. It's a warning. He also warns his people. He warns the ordinary Jews who were in the city because their enthusiasm, "Save us," was not matched with knowledge, because in a few days the same crowd would shout, "Crucify, crucify." And so if you're amongst that kind of person who is enthusiastic at first, you're super excited in the beginning of something, some work of God in your life, and then you lose interest over time and become discouraged or even angry, Jesus is warning you too. There is no triumph without suffering. He also warns the Jewish leaders. So this is a warning, I would say, for pastors and elders and anyone who has experience in the church, older men and women of God who've been in the church for many years. The true nature of kingship is one that overturns our traditions, isn't it? It's surprising. It's uncomfortable. And we can never forget that we are in need of his salvation. It isn't, after all, the workers who rejected the stone. It's the builders. It's the leaders who rejected the stone. The blood of the covenant is something that we can never forget that we need. The thanksgiving offering of Psalm 118 is something that we must remember Jesus made for sinners like us. And so all of us, whether we're in authority in civil government, whether we're in authority in the church, or we're simply amongst the rank and file, we are all warned today by this Palm Sunday, Passion Sunday, triumphal entry, that the victory has to come through the cross. In conclusion, one study guide I consulted for this morning's message gave a helpful drama between two hypothetical people, what the author of this little drama called a local guy, someone who lived in Jerusalem, and then a visitor. Because at Passover, people would come from all across the world, really, to be a part of this great Jewish feast. So the local guy says, "Shalom, what's up? Where are you from?" He's speaking to one of the pilgrims who've come at a distance. "Hey, I'm from Alexandria. This is the second time I came here for the Passover. But this time things seem different. There's something exciting in the air. What's going on?" "Yeah, I've noticed it too. It's all because of this man named Jesus of Nazareth. He's been doing some fantastic miracles, like turning water into wine and feeding a crowd of 5,000 with only 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish and opening the eyes of a man born blind." "No kidding. I've never heard of such a thing. How can a man perform such miracles? Is he the Messiah that we learned about?" "I'm not sure, but I know one thing. His miracles are for real. They're not just optical illusions or special effects." "Well, how do you know?" "Well, let me tell you. I was in Bethany last week with some of my friends to attend a funeral of this man named Lazarus. We helped to wrap his dead body with linen and put him in a tomb. And then he came, Jesus of Nazareth. And when he called out the man's name, Lazarus, he came out. He staggered out with the linen still wrapped around his body. It was the most incredible thing I have ever seen." "Wow." "I know, but our religious leaders are unhappy about Jesus of Nazareth. I think they're jealous of him. They're also afraid that they're going to lose their positions when people go over to Jesus and start following his teachings. So there's been rumors that they're trying to put him to death." "Really? That's crazy." "Yeah, now they're watching if Jesus will dare to show up for the Passover, and people are in suspense. Do you think he will show up? I want to see him." Yeah, I do think he's going to show up. In fact, I hear some noise. I hear some shouts. Let's go see what it is. Despite the fact that this royal announcement is different than what you'd expect, despite the fact that this royal announcement combines suffering and victory, we need to go see him. We need to go see what this noise is. We need to make some noise because this Messiah has come to save us. We need to go see him because he is warning us that we may have it wrong, that we may be thinking in the wrong category from what God is thinking. And so when we go to see him, we need to be prepared that he's different than what we think. He's not your typical king. He's better. Let's worship him. Lord God, as we bow in prayer now, we acknowledge that this triumphal entry is one that is critical for us to grasp, especially in this matter of combining, as I've tried to do this morning, Father, combining the victory of God with the defeat of God. Lord, there are those here this morning who are struggling in their weakness, who are struggling with defeat, who are struggling with confusion, perhaps with illness, perhaps with a relationship, perhaps with goals. And we are fighting our way and we can't seem to make it. We're constantly disappointed by the people around us. And we feel like we have been defeated. Is this not, Lord, the victory which you have promised, that when we are weak, then you are strong? Lord, may we sing your praises. Hosanna, Lord, save us. May we go and see what the commotion is all about. And may we worship you. Amen.